I've been studying art since 2012 and I have amassed a lot of artwork edits specifically for university. Let me show you a good amount so you can get an insight into the development I had parallel to the art I produced for myself. These are the first pieces of art I did in high school. With these I had some portfolio guidance, in which I was told to stick to a specific topic, so that my work would be more consistent and easier to read what my goal was, rather than looking like a bunch of different people had done it. From the comments on my previous videos, I've gathered that it's a popular belief that the teacher's motivation is to push you out of some comfort zone. But I've made the experience that you're going to have a hard time as an artist if you switch motives, media and style with every painting. For example, why should they take you seriously for gluing forks and spoons to a museum wall when all you've done before was landscape painting? So I started a sketchbook as I was recommended to gather ideas by drawing and collecting illustrations and doing obligatory sketches on the train. I finally found a topic that I was interested in for the portfolio, owls, which admittedly isn't really innovative, but apparently that didn't matter. Animals are a great topic for art projects in general, because when people ask you what you are working on, you can always say that you are studying the feathers, their structure, fur and texture, or that you are interested in the formal elements that make the pattern. That makes it pretty easy to legitimize your work compared to other topics like climate change, political activism and similar topics, which all require you to demonstrate deeper involvement to explain your concept. But still, I'm not used to working on one topic, so I had some other projects as well. One of the girls in that portfolio guidance was recommended to collect dead birds and roadkill and to present it in vacuum bags, which was weird, but because I thought that was a thing, it influenced me somewhat in just drawing a dead opossum that would merge out of lines and then dissolve. I also had done a series of sketches that were very linear. The portfolio guidance told us that as artists, every line we do is done on purpose, so why would we use an eraser? That would just mean we admitted a mistake, which would decrease our credibility as artists. In that case, I thought sketches done with the continuous line are more convincing than accurate depictions of my motive. I also did a bunch of still lifes because I thought those shouldn't be left out when applying for art. I used a book for portfolios for help, but in the final presentation they didn't really matter. Next are some analog photographs that I did in my first seminar, where I discovered photography for myself. We got some DSLRs and made a camera obscura to work with. The professor was nice and questions like what makes photography art or if there were any originals in photography really interested me. Needless to say, a lot of the seminars I visited were photography seminars. But at the same time I also visited a graphic seminar that was about self-portraits. I started with bringing a collage and an etching I did in high school, but during the seminar I got inspired by the accuracy of Käthe Kollwitz's self-portrait. But the feedback I got directed me to become more abstract. My hair was red at the time, so I used that as a distinctive feature and mainly used red ink or blue for contrast. The more abstract and sketchy I worked, the more accepting they became, and after different approaches, even with pencils and fineliner, I ended up using watercolor in a very rough manner. Next drawings are from nude painting lessons. While I've trashed the paintings after passing the seminar, I have a few drawings left. We had 5 to 15 minutes for each pose, which after a few tries made it obvious that it wasn't about naturalistically drawing or painting the body. Rather, it was about getting something done on paper, focusing on compositions and other aspects. That led to weird situations, like when after 15 minutes one of the students had only drawn about 3 lines on the paper, she said she couldn't find the courage to draw or even attempt the hand. This led to the professor praising the non-attempt, claiming that it still works. She gathered the students around the lines, trying to sell them as done on purpose, while the student was just unsatisfied with their own performance. The next works are a lino cut and 2 etchings. As you can see, I didn't want to deny my manga background completely. As I worked on the Kingdom Hearts lino cut, a fellow student recognized the game and was reminiscing about her past. Apparently her fear that her interest in manga would in some way become a disadvantage caused her to give all her manga books and everything related away. So she wouldn't even consider consuming them in private anymore? So I tried mixing manga motifs with a medium that today is only used for artistic expression. I also did an etching of one of my digital motifs that I worked on at that time, trying my best to get the hang of it. Out of admiration, I then fully edged a manga page from the Greyman to show that actual manga consists of more than big eyes and hentai. I wanted to make the contrast visible between a manga page being a tiny part of a mass-printed product and focusing on it being a delicate and careful handmade work of art. If you took every panel by itself, it probably wouldn't even look like manga on the first view. So I invested weeks of work carving line after line in the foil, but of course it got roasted. That destroyed the idea of convincing people who only stick to their own values. Me and my brother did a bunch of paintings of faces. He studies design, but depending on the seminar, design and art don't really differ in my experience. Because designers also know, there is no better way to sell your design than labeling it as contemporary art, which adds a touch of culture to it. Anyway, the idea of this project was to deconstruct what makes recognizable facial features, which isn't really innovative, but was good enough to use up some paints that otherwise would have dried out. And even though they had no other purpose than being done for university, it was a lot of fun to work on them freely, not caring about proportions, wasting material or anything like that. I showed those to my professor and he really hated them. But 2 weeks later I brought them with me again, and the exact same professor apparently didn't remember his judgment from earlier, praising it as some kind of second Baselitz. I changed back to graphic and tried some new things like constructing room with lines or negative space. But that didn't last long, since manga wasn't allowed, but in my free time I also loved to do fan arts of musicians, I thought I could include that in a series of Nitro for Trash. For that I used the watercolor paintings I did and printed them on paper that you would use for an actual newspaper. With nail polish remover I rubbed it on watercolor paper, the way you would do with an adhesive tattoo you get out of a gumball machine. Then I would use a wash of watercolor to add another layer to it. Honestly, I hadn't really had any idea where I was going with that project, so I called it an experiment. Another project of that kind was a book named after a colleague of mine, Melissa. It is a self-made book that was a group work of her, Ecolux and me, and it contains pages filled with numbers. Those are the hex color codes of every single pixel of a photo of Melissa. If you were to input them back into a computer, they would recreate the photograph. At least, we presented it that way. But in reality, the picture we used for the process was a fan art of Link and Dark Link from The Legend of Zelda we found on Tumblr, because we couldn't be bothered to actually take a photo of Melissa. We knew the difference wouldn't matter. We got highly praised for the book, because it seemed so intellectual for those who wanted to believe. But if you ask anyone with a little knowledge of digital images, the whole thing turns out to be very trivial. The next project dealt with photography again. We were supposed to make a little booklet that gives an introduction to the basics of photography. So we were divided into groups to write a text about the assigned topic. After that, the text as a whole was given to everyone in order for us to illustrate the book in our own way. Usually you would use photographs to illustrate the different aspects, but I was really interested in that whole Russian constructivism thing, so I wanted to try a different approach, using only schematic geometric shapes and a simplistic color scheme. The aperture, for example, would be illustrated by hexagons shaped out of surrounding triangles. After that, I visited more photography seminars again, and another project dealt with the biochemical department of our uni. The photos you see were done in those buildings and laboratories. Photography in general was my favorite because I didn't need to justify myself in a way I had to regarding my drawings and paintings. It was really all about what interests you, and there really was no limit. You even could use your cell phone if it supports your concept. But after all, my passion still is drawing and watercolor. So one day I brought another self-portrait among others that I received good feedback on. My other work was trash, but since that self-portrait apparently had conveyed something personal, I was requested to keep working in that direction. I did a series of portraits of myself and my brother, which were criticized on a technical level. The sketch underneath the color would limit me to only color in lines, so I should leave them out. This brought me to the series of Alice Glass paintings, which I talked about in the previous video regarding that topic. Since I wanted to do portraits for my exam, I also needed to be influenced by something, because otherwise, what would we talk about in that oral exam? So they showed me Marlene Dumas and Jenny Saville, and after watching some interviews of Marlene Dumas, I found her quite sympathetic. I handled it the way I did a new painting. No sketches, painting something on paper that was initiated by photos of Alice Glass in less than 2 to 5 minutes. Not giving a damn about the accuracy, because as far as I knew, that would only get me into trouble explaining myself. When I was asked in that exam what I did before and after showing them my manga work, I knew studying art in my case is not about leaving comfort zones, but knowing your audience. They just want to see work that is consistent and would be accepted by those in the contemporary art scene. So please don't understand this as me complaining. I just want to make you aware of how studying art can be before you apply for something you expect to be totally different. As I hope to make clear with this video, I accepted the situation and adapted to it, even though their methods often seem logically inconsistent to me. For more on that, watch my previous video, Why Isn't Illustration Art?